My name is Seth Harris, and I'm going to walk you through the technical process of composing this oil painting, step by step. I should warn you that I'm going to talk a lot, and that may not be your thing. If so, you can skip to the 3-minute mark and turn the sound off. Before I started painting, or even sketching, I had an idea. I wanted to create a painting of my friend Kat as she got ready to go to the beach. I scheduled a photo shoot with her at her apartment, conveniently on a day that we were all actually going to the beach for a friend's birthday party. I set up dramatic lighting and took many pictures, all with slight variations. This one ended up being my favorite. But let's remove some of the extraneous details that may distract the viewer. The patterns on the fabric, the shelf in the background, and the windowsill. This piece has to be composed in a way that attempts to redirect the viewer's eye along several contrast points. Beginning with the bag, moving along the edge to the towel, along her arm, and then up to her bandana. It follows a Fibonacci spiral, which is what you see here. That's just something I like to incorporate in my paintings once in a while. From the reference photograph, I created a rough charcoal sketch as a one-to-one reference for the piece. It's a good idea to keep something like this around while you paint as a guide to your proportions. Here I'm using gray paper. Some people like white or sepia. Michelangelo simplified the process further and actually used tracing paper for his scale references. Nowadays, you don't even need paper. You can use a tablet or a computer. But you should just use what works for you. The point is really just to have something as a reference to check your measurements. You'll need brushes or palette knives that work for your technique. Here's what I used. I tend to favor all-purpose brushes over those specifically made for oil. And I'd get a variety of sizes too, and multiple of those sizes. I use filberts and flat shaders for the broad areas, double and triple out rounds for the detail. What matters is that you, again, find what works for you. These are the pigments that I use for this painting. I show you this because I want to be clear on exactly what paints I used, as it is important. I will switch between tubes of artist-grade and student-grade paint throughout a piece, but mostly I just work with one manufacturer because I prefer the use of alkali refined linseed oil as a binder. It dries faster than the more common safflower oil blends, but again, that's my preference. Most manufacturers will print what pigments and binders they use on the back label. It's good to get in a habit of checking this before you buy. And again, here's a list of the pigments that I used. Hopefully this is a little more readable. I prefer to paint on a pre-stretched artist-grade canvas. Artist-grade is a relative term, so I'm basically looking for a painting surface that is on the thick side, but not too coarse. This is another topic of preference, though. Most pre-stretched canvases come surfaced white, but I never paint on a white canvas. I always coat my canvases with some form of black or darkened gesso. In this case, I'm using a black acrylic gesso, which dries quickly to a matte surface. And make sure you wait at least 24 hours before you use it to paint. Not shown in this video is the somewhat lengthy process of creating the underdrawing. I first drew a Fibonacci spiral, and then chalked in a sketch based on the reference drawing that I showed earlier. I used a chalk pencil, which is sometimes referred to as white chalk. Now it's time to set up your palette for the painting. I always try to keep my pigments ordered in a similar orientation to what's shown here. It just makes it easier to tell which pigment's which. My skin tones are mostly just four colors. I mix one brush with flake white replacement and blush. The other brush has burnt umber and burnt sienna. You'll notice that the video is being sped up. That's because there's 30 hours of studio time. A glazed portrait is long form art. Also, I apologize for the poor lighting of this video. I mean, I'm a millennial with a day job. My art studio today is an unused conference room at my work after hours. But human beings will make art anywhere. Okay, back to the painting. Throughout a piece, I will keep multiple brushes wet at a time. In this case, I currently have two that are wet, a light and a dark. This is so that I can keep darkening and lightening as needed with flake white replacement, blush, burnt sienna, and burnt umber. Without constantly cleaning the brushes, it just saves time. Later on, you'll see me use a third brush. For some areas that are really dark, I'll add Mars Black. Also, I'll use a fourth brush for areas that are red, like the lips. I'll continue blocking in the face and neck, then I'll put a layer of Mars black over the bandana. Because I'm putting black on top of black, you may wonder, what's the point? I'll put aside the argument over whether this is lazy or not and just say that Mars black isn't the same as black gesso. If you leave a section of black gesso on a finished piece, it may not look like you want it to when you varnish it. Here I'm continuing to block in the torso with burnt umber and burnt sienna. There's some blush being added to the lighter tones for the shoulder and the bust line. Now I'm going to add another brush to the process for the tote bag. This brush will have a mix of flake white replacement and burnt umber. The strap is mostly flake white replacement. Also, I'm going to make the skin tone corrections at the edge of the tote strap. With my dark tone brush, I'm going to edge in the background. This is mostly going to be burnt umber on the right, and with a large clean shader brush, I'm going to load it with flake white replacement and edge in the window side of the figure. Here I'm blocking in a layer of burnt umber and burnt sienna along the darkened portions of the figure's arm and torso. I intend to add a little Mars black over at some point, just for the really dark areas. Typically, I paint a very dark background and contrast that with light skin tone. This is a form of what is often called chiaroscuro. It's in my opinion that this technique is what makes a good painter, photographer, or cinematographer, at least in a classical sense. My hope is for this piece to create the same level of drama, but with a reversal of the composition, so that the background is bright and the skin is mostly dark. The predominant pigment that I'm using in the arm in this area is burnt sienna. I may add some mid-tones later for depth. As you can see, the shine from the wet paint makes it difficult to tell what tone it has. That shine will go away once it dries, as the paint is fairly lean. The hand gets highlights of flake white replacement with a slight blush tint. I use the same brushes to block in the rest of the flesh tone. I'm basically just going to play around with these values until it's blended to where I feel it's okay. It just has to be okay. This is an underpainting. What's important is that you get near the value that you want. You'll notice that the underdrawing is not smearing with the other colors as I use chalk. If you gessoed your canvas in gray or some other medium tone, you could use pencil or charcoal for your underdrawing. Just be aware that it will smear more when you paint over it. Chalk doesn't smear or streak nearly as much as charcoal does. Now I'm mixing in the light and dark tones for the towel. Flake white replacement, titanium buff, and golden ochre for the light. Golden ochre, burnt sienna, burnt umber, and titanium buff for the dark. Once it's mixed, I'll move it over to the canvas and blend. I'm continuing to edge in the background with an undercoat of burnt umber. I'll also use some burnt umber for the shadows while I have it on the brush. I've mixed up some highlights for the bag. Flake white replacement with a tiny amount of burnt umber. Then the shadows of the bag are just burnt umber, and eventually some Mars black for the really dark areas. I've mixed flake white replacement, titanium buff, and burnt umber for the shorts. I started blocking this in with a large shader brush, and then I decided to finish the area with a palette knife. I think it helps to keep a somewhat dreamy texture when you use this technique. Plus, it's fun. Look, maybe painting with a palette knife doesn't actually help my painting look better. Maybe it actually looks worse, but it's worth the risk. There's just something satisfyingly chaotic about it. Now, I'm going to fill in the window area with flake white replacement. Once again, I'll start with a brush, finish with a palette knife. When I use red, I rarely use pure cadmium red. I usually cut it with burnt umber or burnt sienna. And that's what I'm doing here. The highlights I'm using are blush, and the shadows are burnt umber with Mars black. The underpainting will be a little off, as cadmium red is very difficult to get right the first time. I actually don't think I ever get my cadmium red fabrics right the first time I try. It's one of those paints that just improves with proper layering. I've used artist tape to set up boundaries of the window, frame, and molding. I'm painting Mars black between the strips of tape. Now I'm just blocking in the flake white replacement up to the line that I just made. I've painted white strips on the other side of the tape. That's for the molding. That will be painted over later. Now I'm going to mix up the wall color and just move it to the canvas to complete the underpainting. So this is the underpainting. It's kind of rough. Some people who see my work in various stages tell me that they prefer my underpaintings. I'm going to keep painting because I don't feel that I'm done. I prefer work that is more selectively detailed, so I'm going to add a few more glazes to get there. Before I start glazing, I need to address an issue that comes up with every painting that I do. It may not seem so to you, the viewer, but I've been working on this painting for many hours now. Some of these clips are sped up to 160x. At this point, I'm losing my objectivity. My solution for now is to rotate the piece 90 degrees and continue painting. This new orientation resets my perspective and allows me to see issues that I had forgotten about. I apologize if the new camera angle is disorienting. Before we can start painting, though, we need to mix up a glazing medium. I'm using an eyedropper to control the ratios. This is a mixture of two liquids. One will be a fatty oil, which will increase the gloss. The other will be a lean solvent, which will decrease the gloss. The oil that I'm using is called drying poppy oil. My lean solvent is odorless mineral spirits. The ratio of each will change throughout the painting for a variety of reasons. The first glaze here is on the lean side with 60% poppy oil and 40% mineral spirits. The glazing medium is brushed on and you're free to paint additional layers. If you use too much glazing medium, you can wipe it off with a clean rag. You'll have to learn how to spot when there's too much glazing medium. It makes the pigment run. Practice will tell you when too much is too much. Essentially, I spent the next 10 hours of studio time glazing additional layers. The only difference between the overlapping layers is that they have an increased percentage of poppy oil and a decreased percentage of odorless mineral spirits. Another way of saying this is that the medium is getting increasingly fat and decreasingly lean. Remember to paint fat over lean. Also, at this point, you should be painting thick over thin, which is different from fat over lean. There are many online articles that explain the nuances of this concept, so if you're unfamiliar, you should look it up. Now, at this point, I'm satisfied with the piece. I always date and sign my paintings, not like it's required. I just hate ambiguity. Also, it helps put closure to a piece. When there's a signature, it's done. It's good to wait a few months before you varnish. I use Gamvar, which says you don't need to, but I'm not in a rush. Oh, and there's one more thing I didn't show. It's good to clean the painting before you varnish. It just accumulates too much dust and dirt. I used a clean rag and some odorless mineral spirits and wiped it down. Once it dried, I applied 2 coats of varnish. Well, that's the video. Thank you for staying awake. Or if you used it to help you fall asleep, thank you for sleeping.